Welcome to the Charlotte Center Forum featuring Federico Rios. If this is your first time to the forum, welcome. How many of you are first timers? Oh my gosh, that's fantastic. So for the few of you who have returned, welcome back. not sure what that says. So we have a great night ahead and really grateful that you guys are here. So I'm Mark Paris. I'm the executive director of the Charlotte Center for the Humanities and Civic Imagination. So why those two? Why the humanities and civic imagination? So the humanities help us make sense of our lives. They ask questions about what is good and how we should live and what is the right thing to do. And we find answers in stories, in what we believe, in the things that we create, and that's the humanities. That's English and history and poetry and philosophy and the arts. So we think the humanities gives a basis for a different kind of conversation about who we are and who we can be. So what about this civic imagination piece? So civic imagination is simply envisioning a better tomorrow and ways to make it happen. And it turns questions into answers and answers into action. So those are the two things that we bring together. And we bring those two things together to fulfill our mission. And our mission is to help people and communities flourish. So here's our format for tonight. It's really simple. It's connect, consider, ignite. It's really simple, but it's also profound because it turns the programming over to you. So this is audience participation, and you'll find that you guys will be driving the evening. So Connect is an opportunity for you to meet somebody new and to have a conversation that is meaningful, to reveal yourself in a meaningful way. So we invite you to take that risk. Connect. Consider is an opportunity to hear from our speaker. Super excited to have Federico Rios here tonight. So let's give him an anticipatory round of applause. So you'll hear the bio on Federico, and I'm sure all of you are here having already read it, but he's the Senior Vice President for the Robinson Center for Civic Leadership at the Foundation for the Carolinas with a significant task on his hands, and I think he's going to share with you what he has on his mind. So the last piece is Ignite, and Ignite really asks the questions, so what and now what? Having connected, having listened, what difference can we make? And so we will put that back to you, and we'll love to hear your answers. So before we begin, I'd like to thank our partners and donors who make our work possible. All of what we do takes people believing in us. And that's true for everyone in the room. Everything that you do requires people to believe in you. So we're a stronger community when we believe in each other. And I want to thank all of those folks and organizations who've been supportive of us with our mission. I also want to thank our board members and my teammates who also helped make this happen. You'll meet my teammates, Valeta Fullwood and Lillian Parker. Valeta will be leading us in discussion, and Lillian will be sharing some programming news that we're really excited about. I also want to thank Ray Ward for being generous with this space with us. This is an incredible space. I'm sure all the architects in the room are sizing it up. I also especially always want to thank Jennifer Appleby, who is the former CEO of Ray Ward, who was instrumental in our launch 3 years ago. It started with a conversation over lunch, and I'm forever grateful for that conversation. And I also want to thank Katie Woods and Adam Bartimo for all their support and assistance. And we'd like to think of this place as home. And I also want to thank all of you again for coming out. I know many of you. I look forward to getting to know others of you that I do not know. My sense is that all of you are amazing, creative, dynamic, awesome people. So just the fact that you're all here is really a pleasure. So thank you for that. All right, so we begin all of our programs either with a reading or a performance to kind of shift the mood and get us into a certain heart space and head space. And tonight you're going to get both a reading and a performance. And I'm going to start with something of my own that I recently posted online. And then as soon as I finish, we're going to immediately follow with a performance from a young man named Ajon Ellison, who is a senior at Northwest School of the Arts. He's sitting right here with his mom, who showed up. Ajon's going to graduate in just a few days, and he's going to go to Western Carolina University, where he's going to study interior design. And so we're really excited about his future. And this is the second time that we've had a performance from the Northwest School of the Arts, and we hope to continue to lift them up and give them a stage and celebrate them and partner with them. So we're really excited to have Ajon here tonight. So thank you, Ajon. All right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read something to you. And I'm going to take this chair over here. It's a little bit more poetic than that. And so I want you to kind of follow along, and as you do, sort of think about what your own version of this might be. And it's going to lead into the conversation, which will pose some questions. So this is called Begin with Why. I was asked recently, why do you do it? Why do you spend so much energy building an organization, sending out invitations, holding events, hoping people will show up, and doing it again? Wouldn't it be easier not to bother with any of it at all? And of course, it would be. I have a full-time career. I have a family I adore. I enjoy seeing the world. I have projects I'm working on. And there are far more talented people than I am who know how to put on a show. So what's my why? The short answer is, right now, this is who I am. I find joy and satisfaction in the work, for sure. I love people. I love ideas. I love my city. I want to contribute to a better place to live. I want whatever is unique in me woven into the time I am here. But there is a much longer answer about what is good and true about a life well lived. My entire adult life, I've studied philosophy, religion, psychology, history, and the arts that ask enduring questions about meaning and existence. And all the lessons learned tell me this: the surest way to live a satisfying life is to create what you value most. And so, I create the things that matter to me: a marriage that is fulfilling, friendships that are enriching, a mind and body that is sustaining, a household that is nourishing, a career that is inspiring, and a community that is thriving. All of it takes shape in 100 different ways, from intimate conversations to the preservation of memories, to gathering people together. Emily Esfahani Smith, in her book, The Power of Meaning, Crafting a Life That Matters, talks about the four pillars of a meaningful life: belonging, purpose, storytelling, and transcendence. To whom do I belong? To what am I devoted? What do I say about my life? And what are larger causes of which I am a part that take me beyond myself? I can answer each of those questions. I belong to all of life to which I am connected. I am devoted to what I don't know. I am grateful for every experience I have had. And I am lost and found in something bigger when writing these words. That is my why. Ajon, come on up.
Good evening, everybody. Hope you all are having a great night. Hope you all enjoyed the song. All the world over, so easy to see. People everywhere just wanna be free. Listen, please, listen, that's the way it should be. There's peace in the valley, people have to be free. yeah. Come on, clap your hands.
You should see what a lovely, lovely world this could be. Everyone learn to live together. It seems to me it's such an easy, easy thing it should be. Why can't you and me learn to love one another? Oh, 'cause all around the world it's so easy to see. People everywhere just wanna be free. If you ask me my opinion will be, there's peace in the valley, people have to be free. Oh yeah. Look, if there's a man who is down and needs a helping hand, all it takes is you to understand and to pull him through. It seems to me we gotta solve this individually. And I'll do unto you what you do to me. Shouting from the mountain all out to the sea. There's no two ways about it, people have to be free. If you ask me my opinion will be that it's a natural situation for a man to be free. Oh yeah, just get right on board now. Hey, hey, I can't explain this feeling that's come over me. It's enough to move a mountain, make a blind man see. Come on everybody, come on, let's go see. There's peace in the valley, now we all can be free. Oh yeah.
Thank you.
So again, thank you for coming out to the forum, and this is a new event for you. As Mark mentioned, we go through a series of segments starting with Connect. So that's where we're going to go into. And I have two questions for you. But first, I want you to identify somebody near to you, preferably somebody you didn't come with or somebody you don't know, and introduce yourself, and then engage in a chat around these two questions. What do you value, and what's your why? And so we're going to give you a little bit more time than we usually do, so feel free to engage for about the next 15 minutes or so.
Everyone. My name's Jennifer, and I introduced myself to LaShawn, and as soon as he started telling me what he was doing, I knew exactly who he was because I was sitting in a committee meeting, he works for the county, about, I don't know, 6 months ago, listening to him lay out a vision for how they were going to take the equity report that Mecklenburg County had done. And so I actually do know him, we have a lot of friends in common and common passions, and it was just so great to reconnect. Relatively new to the Charlotte area, and looking forward to connecting and continuing what we described as the beginning of a longer conversation. So thank you very much for the opportunity.
I wanted to share with you a little bit about Federico, our speaker for today. Federico Rios currently serves as the Senior Vice President for the Robinson Center for Civic Leadership at Foundation for the Carolinas. He serves as a member of the leadership team and provides leadership, strategic planning, and management for the foundation's civic engagement efforts. Federico formerly served as the City of Charlotte's first assistant director over the Office of Equity, Mobility, and Immigration Integration. He managed the city's efforts in diversity, equity, inclusion, economic mobility, and immigrant integration. Federico spent 8.5 years with Communities and Schools of Charlotte-Mecklenburg and served as the founding director of the Newcomer Services Program. He is a recipient of La Noticia's 2018 Excelente Award for Community Service Person of the Year, and the 2020 Cesar Chavez Leadership Award, and Charlotte is Creative's Bolt of Inspiration Award. His proudest accomplishments, however, is being the husband of his wife, Lakeisha, who's joining us this evening, as well as being the father to two boys, Elias and Jaden. And with that, I introduce you to Federico.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Wow. This is weird, having people that high up looking down. I know my wife was referenced, but I am so grateful to have her here with me. It's a lot having me go on a road tour, which is what the last few weeks with the Foundation for the Carolinas feels like. And so I'm so grateful to have you here. Thank you for being here and being supportive of me. And of us, because I get to tell our story a bit, and I know you how much you love that. So thank you, Mark, again, for affording me the opportunity to tell my story. Thank you to the team and to Ray Ward for making this venue available. Mark and I, as he's referenced in times past, had an opportunity to do a podcast. I had an opportunity to do his podcast a couple years ago and was included in a book that he did. And I was just sharing before we started that when I did that, I had this lack of desire to ever listen to it, right? Poured my heart out. I think I cried a little bit during it, and had no desire. And fast forward a few years after that, my father passed away, and I had an opportunity to listen to what I said, and it was so poignant and meant so much to me. And so, Mark, I think that means whenever you call on me, I'm willing to come. But really grateful to have this opportunity with everyone. Thank you all for making the time. So I've been told that everyone's story starts in the middle of someone else's story. And I think it's absolutely necessary to start with my parents, who I've alluded to. And I'll just give you the highlights, or what I think the highlights are. So my dad, Alejandro Rios, was born in Puerto Rico in November 1941. Can't give you an exact date because nobody knows what the exact date was. And that's a testament to just how interesting my father's life was. He was born to two wonderful, well, no, take that back. He was born to two parents. I felt his spirit say, no, take that back. My grandfather was not the best person to deal with and be around. And my father had a number of challenges in his life that expressed themselves throughout the time that I had with him. And so at 16 years old, he had a final violent exchange with my grandfather after a back and forth in public. My grandfather got drunk that night, went home, and beat him while he was sleeping. His older brother interfered. It turned into, you have to leave now. And my father, at 16 years old, left everything he knew to move to New York City. My father was a fifth grade dropout. Let that sit for a second. It makes no sense to me that a person that was born in the United States, in Puerto Rico, in 1941, was somehow able to opt out of the education system that early. But the truth was that he probably had a learning disability, and in spite of that, he was probably the smartest person I ever met in my life. He was a genius, and just an amazing person to be around. My father did not know how to dance, but he was, his words danced at every party we were at. He literally commanded a group of people. And so when I tell stories, as I'm doing tonight, I think of him because it's him that's coming through. My mother, who passed a year and 2 weeks after he passed in 2020, was an immigrant from Colombia that arrived in this country in 1969, so approximately 4 years removed from both the Civil Rights Act and the Immigration Act passing. She came to be reunited with family members. She was the salt of the earth, most wonderful person I've ever met, and I am completely and totally biased in that respect. My mother was just an amazing person. I'm challenged because as I was thinking about telling this part of the story, I always land in this space where I want to talk about my mother being this hardworking person. And I'm challenged by that because that's often the narrative that gets coupled with immigrants. Their value is in their work. I'm here to tell you my mother's value was in her humanity, who she was, what drove her to work, the desires that she had for herself and for her children. It's impossible to tell her story without telling the work story, right? And so she busted her ass every day to provide for us. 30 plus years at the same job. And it was an arduous job. In fact, the staircase, interestingly enough, reminds me of her job because her job had an incredibly long staircase that she had to walk up and down every day. I remember when I'd visit her and think about the flight of stairs that she had to go up. There was no elevator, and my mother had no cartilage left in her knees by the time, towards the last few years of her career. And she did that every day to provide for us. My mother never learned English, never got her ears pierced, never drove a car. In spite of that, she did so, so much in this world. She was the most loving, caring person. She would only interrupt her prayers to curse at my father. It's actually true. And she was just this amazing individual that gave me everything. So here I come along in 1981. I was born in Manhattan, raised in Jamaica, Queens. I think there's a couple people here from Queens. And had an interesting upbringing. Come 1986, we moved into our first home. And when I say first home, it was anybody in that family's first home. And we found a place, my parents found a place right outside of JFK Airport, if you're familiar with New York City, in a small area called South Ozone Park. New York is a huge city, but is really just a bunch of small towns knit together. And so South Ozone Park is this working class community. Again, adjacent to the airport. If you know anything about Queens, the borough, it's the most diverse county in the country. Some say the world. The popular euphemism now is if you grew up in Queens, you grew up in the future, because the future is a diverse experience. And so I had the privilege of growing up in the future. So I grew up in Queens, and we moved to this house. I'm 4 years old. I remember my first Christmas being there because I got both the Hulk Hogan and Andre the Giant figures that I wanted. That was a great Christmas. And then I started kindergarten at the school that was literally on my block, St. Anthony of Padua School, which was a K-8 school with approximately 250 students. And we were on our way, right? Father had made it far enough, saved enough to buy his first home. I'm in a good school. My brother and I are, for all intents and purposes, thriving. A year and 6 months, so a year and a half after my father purchased his home, the first significant bout of tragedy occurs in my life. My father was the facilities manager at the Cross Island YMCA out in Long Island. And during his shift, he went to take out the trash. And there was some construction that was happening in the boiler area. Unfortunately, one of the, if you ever walk the streets in New York, you'll see like these plates on the floor that are, you open up and you go to the basement of whatever building is there. And so imagine a plate like that, and it was left unsecured. My father unfortunately fell into a condensation tank full of burning hot water and oil, had tremendous burns on his legs that took 3 months of physical therapy and recuperation, and it knocked us out. You know, here we were seemingly upwardly mobile. Again, a fifth grade dropout and an immigrant mother who just graduated high school only, never spoke English, worked a dead-end job, and we were making it, and then life stopped everything in its tracks. And that was the beginning of this vacillation between being what I would consider working class and being poor. And never feeling really stable because I was going back and forth between these realities, right? Sometimes things were good. Sometimes they were incredibly challenging. In spite of my father's injuries, thankfully they did not take his leg as they had initially thought that they would. He was able to make a living. He actually worked under the table because according to the state of New York, he was disabled and collected a whopping $250 every 15 days to provide for his family. And so he made ends meet by doing things that he wasn't technically supposed to do. It was a difficult time, but it was also a time I think back to fondly because I had loving parents, amazing parents. They didn't know much about what it is. They didn't have a roadmap for what it is they wanted for me. What they knew was, you got to go to school because that's the way you make it. And think about this coming from a fifth grade dropout and a mother who just had not had that experience. Now, a facet of this story that I rarely ever tell because I really lean into the poverty piece is my mother's background. So my mother came from Colombia, and she was the daughter of my namesake, Federico Guillermo Arango, who was a mayor of Barranquilla, Colombia, the third largest city in Colombia. In fact, I've shared this with Rafa because I'm very proud of this. He was the highest ranking diplomat in the United Nations for Colombia. He was an incredibly intelligent, well-spoken businessman, politician, philanthropist. And because my mother was not born to the wife that he ended up taking on during his political career, but came before, my mother got none of the benefits of that. Another way to think about that is when you're a black or brown person in this country, it only takes a generation to lose everything. And sometimes it's within the generation you've gained everything, right? And so I think about that often as I do my work. I got a whole bunch more tragedy, but I'm gonna try to swing through that real quick to get to the good stuff. Fast forward, I end up in college somehow. Mark, I think you like to have me tell this part of the story. I know we've talked about it. I distinctly remember my first year of college, I went to Hofstra University because no one loved me enough to tell me don't go to a school that costs that much. And it was the only one that accepted me, and it was based on my SAT grades because I sucked at high school. I got a 16-year-old now that has the same tendencies that I want to choke. He doesn't believe in homework. I didn't believe in homework. What's the purpose of going to school and then having to do stuff if I just went, right? Right? It just doesn't make sense. I disagree completely with that theory now that I have a 16-year-old. But I was in this place where, you know, I just was getting by. And got into a school, got accepted into that school, and it was way too expensive. And I paid through loans, but there was still more that had to be paid. And I remember one time going to my dad and going, Dad, I don't know how I'm gonna do this. And again, this is someone that had been reinforcing to me for so long, you gotta go to school to make it, you gotta go to school to make it. I don't know what my father did. To this day, I have no clue. All I know is we had that conversation, and within a short time, he came back home. He left, came back home, told me, open your hand, and he put a knot of money in my hand and said, you go get your education. An experience that sits with me, will sit with me for the rest of my life. It showed what he valued, right? Fast forward, I end up at St. Francis College with the beautiful woman that is now my wife, and I do a little bit better, get my grades up, and end up at the school that I wanted to end up in my third year. Finally, I end up where I wanted to go, and it's not that expensive because it was a state university, Stony Brook University. While I'm there, I arrived in August of 2001. That's vitally important. Arrive in August 2001. I get informed that we can't take any more loans from you, Mr. Rios. You've maxed those out with your really bad decision in year one. So you're gonna have to find somebody to co-sign. And I didn't have the social capital. You'll hear social capital come up more to make a decision around this. And so I called my oldest cousin, my cousin Gabriel, and he said he couldn't do it. Him and his wife, who had a newborn, who had a one-year-old at this point, about to be one-year-old, could not help me. So I didn't know what to do. I was kind of just going to class, waiting for them to tell me you couldn't do that anymore. And September 11th happens. Well, Gabe's wife passed away on September 11th. And I dropped everything to go be with Gabe. Gabe's wife passed away in part. She was in the second tower of the World Trade Center on the 91st floor for an organization called Fiduciary Trust. She passed away in part because she held the door open for everyone else to get out of her building. Her best friend and their boss passed that day. I dropped everything. I went. I took dental records to the armory. I remember, I will never forget the smell of Manhattan. And I just spent time with Gabe. I answered phones. I took care of things. I could say that at that moment, helping felt good. And it felt like what I was meant to do on a broader scale. I could say at that moment, I also saw Emmy and what she did and thought about it in relation to what I wanted to do for the rest of my life. I wanted to help people. I wanted to sacrifice. I went back to school. Obviously, this is in the New York area. The tragedy has struck. Everybody's kind of in the midst of that. And a couple weeks into going back to school, Gabe calls me and he says, I will pay for the rest of your college education. So it was yet again this, this thought of you give of yourself and someone takes care of you. It takes care of itself, right? It all comes together. So fast forward, I finally graduate eventually. And my wife and I end up working at a residential facility with 125 boys, juvenile delinquents, sexual offenders. The juvenile delinquents loved Keisha. I was with more of the kids that were in the care of the Office of Mental Health in New York State. And it was an interesting way to come out of college, right? It's an interesting way to get life experience. You realize all that you're blessed with, and in spite of all the tragedies I've shared, it's not a microcosm of what many of those kids faced. So it gave you perspective, and it gave me a love for serving and being there for others. And it was my first venture into serving other people. And so, and then we moved, because apparently that was the best thing for us to do. So I can say now, looking back, I moved because my perception of what God was saying to me at that moment, who and how I define God, was telling me, you gotta leave. You gotta leave. You can't be here. If you want your marriage to work, you gotta go. If you want to get to where I intend for you to go, you gotta go. And so we left everything. My wife was 6 months pregnant. We had no job lined up. I cashed out our 401k. I was insane. It was the craziest thing you could have imagined. Within a week, my wife was like, you need to go apply at Walmart. I said, I got a college degree. I have accolades from my last job. We were just making six figures between the two of us. So I shook my fist at the sky a lot, wondered what the heck was I doing here. And then things just started falling into place in the weirdest of ways. I'll fast forward a bit in the interest of time. I ended up at communities and schools. And I heard some folks reference building community. It was at communities and schools with other people that were serving that I built my community. It was at communities and schools that I ended up at Hidden Valley. And I don't think anyone else in the city of Charlotte would say this, but Hidden Valley saved my life. It gave me purpose. It was me serving the same moms that my mother was. An immigrant trying to figure it out, trying to get their child into the best possible situation. Hidden Valley was home in a lot of respects. Because when I went home, things were siloed. My neighbors didn't, I don't know who my neighbors were. There was just not that connection. But something about Hidden Valley formed community, gave me a sense of purpose. Working with other people's and other individuals and communities and schools gave me that sense of purpose. You all know I left communities and schools. I ended up with the city, as Valeda said, where I was able to lead some efforts regarding first immigrant integration. That's what brought me into the work. And then we expanded into diversity, equity, inclusion, and economic mobility. Our economic mobility work was really our violence intervention work, still is. And it was work that I was passionate about. And again, spoke to a part of the work that we had done with young people, the work I knew that I would have benefited from being in the community I was in at that time. Again, I was born in New York City in the 80s during the crack era. And so much overlay goes with what young people are experiencing. Why did I leave the city? So I left the city because this is a once-in-a-lifetime role. Any of you that knew Brian Collier, have worked with Brian Collier, know that he's a genius. I had the blessing of my life getting the opportunity to work alongside of him. Please say that to him. Tell him Federico said that. On several projects, I was a member of the Leading on Opportunity Council. And it was in the midst of that that I actually said to my wife and a friend, I think my dream job would be Brian's job. And I said that like 6 years before this opportunity ever opened. And so when it did, I couldn't not go for it. This opportunity is really a number of things for me, right? It's how do we think of the sense of community? How do we really invest in civic engagement? How do we get neighbors to become real neighbors? One of the things that happened when I was going through the process was an individual shared with me their perspective on the foundation. And I know I have some foundation staff here, so if they giggle or something, I know that they've heard it before. The foundation is the nonprofit bank, right? It's where people go to get money. It's where nonprofits go to get money. And I think people say that, parrot that, without realizing what they're really saying. I think they're not just speaking to the financial piece of what it is to be a foundation, but they're also speaking to the culture. It seems stodgy. It seems buttoned up. It seems inaccessible. So I've taken to start saying that I don't want us to be the nonprofit bank. I'd like us to be the nonprofit credit union. I'd like us to be a place where people can feel like they're members, that they can access a slew of services and easily connect with individuals around what their need is. And so I'm being mindful of time. I might be over. I don't know. Here's what I'm wrestling with. And again, this ties to the work I've done in my past that I've shared. It ties to my upbringing. It's my why, right? It goes back to all these things. How do we innovate local solutions for national challenges that show up at our doorstep? We have an incredibly divided politic. We have people that won't even talk to one another. How do we address that? How do we build institutional trust at a time in our history where that is completely lacking? How do we help develop communities within deep relationships? So I think about when I first arrived, I was so disconnected. And I was disconnected in part because I came for what I got, right? I came to be away from the hustle and bustle. I came to have my own car, which we couldn't afford the insurance on in New York. I came to be separate, to be insulated. It wasn't until years in that I realized, no, I need connection. How do we build connection, even for those people that think they're coming to be isolated, that want to live in that silo that we often challenge against? How do we build continuums of care and support amongst groups of people and nonprofits? We've been cultivated to believe that nonprofits should compete against one another around scarce, limited funding. How do we get them to work collaboratively? How do they build a continuum so that, hey, I've served this family, and now they're at a place where you can serve this family based on what you do, right? How do we do a better job at doing that? How do we address the root causes of community violence? Not just the issue, but what caused the issue? This one's hard. I was looking at LaShawn a second ago. What could diversity be? What can we begin to speak to it as in a city that has for so long seen it as a black and white issue? And I'm not just saying that because I'm Latino, although I'm fairly racially dubious. How do we speak to class? How do we speak to station in life? How do we speak to disability? How do we speak to sexual identity and gender and all these other dynamic issues? How do we go beyond what we've become comfortable talking? The last thing I'll say that I've wrestled with is a sense of identity for our community. So I've said a number of times now, I'm from New York. My dad was from Puerto Rico, my mother was from Colombia, but they would both also say that they were from New York. They would say that they were New Yorkers. When I run into people that live in Charlotte and you have a conversation with them, where are you from is one of the questions that gets asked. And people hang on to that place that they're from. They don't become Charlottesians, seemingly. How do we begin to help people get a sense of, I'm here now, this is home, this is where I'm from? So these are the questions I wrestle with. I'll, you know, so you all don't just think I'm asking questions, but I'm also moving towards things. I'd say to you that mental health is a giant priority for me, based on my own struggles with mental health, based on some of what I've already shared. I've been traumatized, y'all. And how do we better structure supports around mental health, especially in communities of color? I'm really keyed in on strengthening the nonprofit ecosystem. What are the ways that we as a foundation do that? Just through our giving, just through the way that we approach hand-holding organizations through a process and not expecting them to just know or just have the social capital to get through a process, but rather being the social capital for them. How do we commit to all of the holes in our affordable housing toolbox? How do we fill those holes? How do we commit to finding innovative solutions for those challenges? Because prices aren't going down. People are still coming. How do we make sure everyone can live together in a community? I think our answers are proximate to our challenges. I think the people that face these challenges more readily have solutions, and they can be further informed by the best practices that exist in communities outside of ours. We can be an innovation lab. We can be a place where we test out things that are different and new. We can continue. And that's my hope for this city.